Welcome to the second panel of the World After Brexit and Trump Conference. I will try and moderate this session. This panel is actually about troubled times in a divided world. In my opinion, I would rather say interesting times and unique in a divided world, but let's see how troubled they are. Our first speaker would be Andrew Bernstein. He's a PhD in philosophy, teaching at the University of New York. He actually taught some courses also at Harvard University and Stanford, University of Chicago and Yale. He is the author of numerous books, but I will just go over the Capitalist Manifesto, the Historic, Economic, and Philosophic Case for Laissez-Faire, and Objectivism in One Lesson, an Introduction to the Philosophy by Ayn Rand. So we'll hope we'll have a very interesting talk, and we are waiting for your questions at the end of the session, please. So let's hear our speakers. Andrew, you have the floor.
Thank you. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
All right. There's a kid from Brooklyn speaking in Bucharest. How cool is that? like the moderator said, I'm a philosopher, not an economist, so I'm going to come at this from a somewhat different perspective. And first, I could just show off some of the books that he mentioned, The Capitalist Manifesto, Capitalism Unbound, several of my books, if anybody wants to take a look at this. I'm going to start off by doing what's rarely done in political discourse, and that is I'm going to define my terms. All right. Now, I'm a supporter of capitalism and of real capitalism, of laissez-faire, just like Ayn Rand was. And by capitalism, I mean the system of individual rights. That's what capitalism is. That's what I'm concerned to uphold and support. That your life belongs to you. It does not belong to the state. It does not belong to the church. It does not belong to the family. Your life belongs to you. And that includes, of course, critically includes the right to own property, the right to earn and to own property, to earn the money to buy land, to buy your own home, to buy your own farm, to buy your own land, and it's yours. And property rights are absolutely indispensable to human life on Earth. It's impossible to live, and I mean impossible, I don't mean difficult, it is impossible to live if you do not have the right to own property. If somebody could take from you your land, your home, your bank account, your food, whether it's criminals or governments or Marxist thugs, if they could take away your property, then how can you live if they have the right, the power to steal your food, your home, etc. So individual rights means it includes, you know, the rights in both the sphere of personal morality and in economics. The right to freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of intellectual expression, the right to read or view whatever materials you like, and in the economic sphere, of course, the right to, like I said, to earn property, to start your own business, to earn profit, to retain profit. Individual rights in both the spheres of personal morality and economics. And notice what individual rights means, that your life belongs to you, means you have the right to seek your own happiness. Thomas Jefferson put that very, very nicely, very exactly in the Declaration of Independence. He did not say the inalienable right to life, liberty, and happiness. He said the inalienable right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. It means you have the right to take actions to gain happiness. You do not have guaranteed right to happiness at somebody else's expense, which of course would violate their rights. Now, notice that capitalism the system is poorly named. The right name for this system is liberalism. All right, liberalism means the philosophy of liberty. It means people who support individual rights. Liberalism does not logically or morally mean a semi-socialist, mixed economy welfare state. I'm a liberal. Bernie Sanders is not a liberal. He's a statist. All right, so is Obama, so is the whole Democratic Party, and sadly, so is much of the Republican Party, especially Trump.
Yeah.
So the principle, the right name for this system of individual rights is liberalism. Now, I can move on to socialism, which has one and only one virtue, and that is it's well named. It means, and that is truly it's the only virtue of socialism. It means the system in which your life has been socialized. Your life does not belong to you, it belongs to society. Your life belongs to the state. And the full socialism, real socialism, is national socialism, Nazism, communism. This is real socialism, your full socialism. Your life belongs to the state. And of course, if your life belongs to the state, then what moral principle constrains the state from disposing of it in any way it sees fit? The answer to that is none. And of course, the socialists have butchered, at minimum, by conservative estimate, 120 million people, innocent civilians in the 20th century, roughly 20 million by the National Socialists and roughly 100 million by conservative estimate, 100 million by the communists. Now, let me conclude the definitions with what's so prevalent today in the modern world, and that is the mixed economy. The kind of a clashing farrago of contradictory elements, part capitalist, part socialist, part free, part statist, part individual rights, part government controls. Notice a pervasive confusion in the world today, how so many people regard the United States as a capitalist system, and Sweden, let's say, and Scandinavia as socialist. Now that is mistaken on both counts. The United States was capitalist, you're very close to laissez-faire, late 19th, turn of the 20th century. But since the so-called progressive era, and again, you know, the great Chinese philosopher Confucius said, see to it that things are called by their right names. Progressives are not progressive. There's nothing progressive about socialism. It's simply regression into statism and government control over the life of the individual. So since the regressive era of the early 20th century, and certainly since the New Deal, or the rotten deal from FDR in the 1930s, the United States has regressed towards socialism. It's very much a mixed economy today. Notice, for example, the socialist elements in the United States. The so-called public school system. And again, that's a euphemism. The proper name, see to it that things are called by their right names. The government school system, which is what it is. The government school system represents the socialization of the educational industry and should be privatized, desperately needs to be privatized. The welfare state in America represents the socialization of the charity industry. The heavily controlled labor markets represents the socialization of the labor markets. I could go on. The alphabet agencies, I can go on and on. Notice, say, in Sweden and the Scandinavian countries, notice the elements of capitalism in Sweden, the heavy elements of capitalism in Scandinavia. IKEA, for example. Oh, that's why even before we get to the economics, notice individual rights, prominently displayed in the Scandinavian countries. Freedom of religion, freedom of speech, freedom of intellectual expression, free to open borders, you're free to emigrate, including in the economics. Notice the elements of private ownership and profit seeking. So IKEA, for example, privately owned and operated for profit. Volvo, privately owned, operated for profit. If you walk down the streets of Stockholm, it's very similar to the streets of my native New York City. All these stores and shops, butcher, baker, candlestick maker, privately owned, operated for profit. It's heavy elements of capitalism. The Scandinavian countries, the United States, they're all mixed economies. It's possible that Sweden has the mixture in Sweden possibly has more, a heavier preponderance of socialist elements and fewer of capitalism, and the United States perhaps has a heavier preponderance of capitalist elements and fewer of socialism. Nevertheless, they're all mixed economies, and the United States, of course, is moving moving relentlessly more deeply into the socialist elements. Now, I want to support global capitalism here. My claim is that global capitalism is not only the best, but is the only hope for world peace and prosperity. The only hope to end oppression and poverty around the world. Now notice capitalism or liberalism born in Great Britain, late 18th century. Notice the principle of individual rights starting to gain currency in Britain. John Locke, of course, is a major player here. Locke, in his two treatises of civil government, published late 17th century, Locke codifies, you know, the growing sentiment in support of individual rights and personal liberties in Britain. And you start to see, during the Enlightenment era in the 18th century, this idea start to gain intellectual and moral currency in the English-speaking world on both sides of the pond, in Britain itself and in her North American colonies. And you see in Britain, you know, the rise of democratic political institutions undermining the political authority of the monarchy, the aristocracy, the official state-established church. And you see, above all, you see the rights of commoners now, not just the aristocrats, but of the common man to get an education, the right to get an education, to develop one's mind, to invent technologies, to come up with new ideas, to start companies, to go into business, to make money. And of course, the paradigm example of this year was James Watt, who perfected the steam engine, the work engine of the Industrial Revolution. I was a penniless Scotsman. Moved down to England, went into business with Matthew Boulton. They mass-produced the steam engine. And of course, the steam engine enabled the Brits to start to mass-produce consumer goods. The single most important thing about this development is that for the first time in human history, human beings are producing consumer goods with more than just muscle power. Their own muscles, or the muscle of draft animals added. The steam engine the machinery is applied mind power. This is applied mind power and enables us to vastly increase the amount of consumer goods. Now, I'm just a dilettante in the field of economics, but I know this much. If you vastly increase the supply of consumer goods, starting with cotton clothing, of course, in the British textile industries, if you vastly increase the supply of consumer goods relative to demand for them, then the price for consumer goods, food above all, will tend to come down, which means real wages, income measured in terms of purchasing power, increase. And you start to see the rising living standards that capitalism is justly famous for. Now, across the pond in the meantime, a revolution occurred that established one of the freest countries of history, at least in the northern states, after the abolition of slavery. The southern states still brutally oppressed Black American citizens. The Jim Crow laws meant brutally enforced racial segregation, lynchings that the legal system did nothing to stop. But in the northern states, this generally did not exist. The northern states of the United States, from the end of slavery in 1865 to the regression into socialism early in the 20th century, that 40 or 50 year window was one of the freest periods of human history. And notice what the country became enormously famous for, the development of applied science and technology. Edison and the electric lighting system, Bell and the telephone, the Wright brothers and aviation, all of that in this period. The development of the distinctively American contribution to architecture, the skyscraper. And this is just, I can go on and on. Henry Ford, of course, revolutionizes personal transportation by mass producing the automobile. I could go on and on with applied science and technology, but it's more than that, as we shall see. Now, until the mid-20th century, capitalism was largely a European and North American phenomenon. But one of the really good things that comes out of World War II, a brutal war which left millions and millions of civilians and soldiers dead. But one of the great things that does emerge in the post-World War II era is the spread of capitalism into a number of nations of Asia. Japan, of course, one of the leading lights of global capitalism. The American occupation of Japan after World War II under General Douglas MacArthur, one of the great successes of American 20th century foreign policy, and I am very critical of American foreign policy, but not in this instance. The American occupation of Japan transformed Japan from a brutal military dictatorship, to put it mildly, into one of the freest nations in Japan. And you see what the freedom in Japan has led to, enormous productivity in so many different fields and rising living standards. And I am a very, very happy driver of a Honda, because I think the Japanese cars are better, and the American companies simply need to compete. But anyhow, Japan, Hong Kong, which was destitute shortly after World War II, but its British colonial leader was a student of Adam Smith, or an admirer of Adam Smith, introduced laissez-faire principles, and Hong Kong's prosperity skyrocketed. And we can say the same for Taiwan and Singapore, where individual rights are at least allowed. They're not, maybe not upheld by law, but they're allowed, certainly in the economic sphere. South Korea, what the Asian tigers have done is they've established a template of how capitalist principle of individual rights, private ownership, and profit seeking can be introduced into poverty-stricken countries. Mao Zedong, I hate to quote that communist butcher, but his term of third world, he coined the term third world nations. What the Asian tigers have done is they've established a template to introduce capitalism, individual rights, including property rights, including especially property rights perhaps, into the starving nations of Asia. This is the template for poor countries around the world, whether it's Zimbabwe or Venezuela, or whether it's Cambodia, or any other nation you want to name. This is the way up and out of poverty, and out of oppression and poverty into freedom and prosperity. Now, individual rights is necessary. Why? This is the last point I want to make. Why? Well, this leads me to Ayn Rand and her great novel, Atlas Shrugged. And everybody should read Atlas Shrugged. It's a brilliant novel literarily, and on top of it, it provides just an extraordinary defense of individual rights and freedom. Now, Ayn Rand, of course, was a Russian immigrant. She was born and raised in Russia. She grew up under the communists. She defected. The theme of Atlas Shrugged is that this, human intelligence, mind power, this is mankind's survival instrument. Literally, she means that literally, just like wings is a bird survival instrument, and if a bird can't fly, it won't be able to swoop down on the prey that it eats, and it will starve to death. Human beings have to think rationally. Rationality is our means of survival. She points out in Atlas Shrugged, every value human life depends upon is a product of the reasoning mind. Food, which needs to be grown, requiring knowledge of agricultural science and agricultural technology, meaning the mind. Medicines have to be researched and developed, requiring biological science. Medical research requires the mind. Houses and buildings, which have to be built, requiring knowledge of architecture and engineering, requiring the mind. To every other value human life depends on is fundamentally a product of the reasoning mind. Now, a professor of mine in graduate school used to say, in order to fully understand the philosopher, you need to know who he, or in this case she, what he's against. You need to know what a philosopher is, not only what a philosopher is for, but also who and what is, in this case, she against. Well, this is directed largely against Marx, right? Marx was a philosophic materialist. Everything was matter. The mind has little value. To some materialists, the mind doesn't even exist. The mind has little role in human life. And of course, Marx, as a philosophic materialist, one, glorifies manual labor, and two, his followers suppress the mind brutally. Now, Rand, acknowledging the role of manual labor, of course, we need to grow food that needs to be physically done. We need to build houses, we need construction workers to physically do it. But first, foremost, and always, to grow food, we need advances in agricultural science and agricultural technology if we're going to feed a population of 7 billion human beings. And we need an architect to understand the principles of architecture, to design how fundamentally we survive and flourish in this world by means of human genius. Second of all, in Atlas Shrugged, Ayn Rand points out there's a political economic condition that the creative function of the mind requires, and that is political economic liberty. Under any form of statism, national socialist or communist, religious or secular, under any form of dictatorship, the mind is suppressed. It follows logically that if your life belongs to the state, which is the essence of statism, of any form, if your life belongs to the state, then your mind belongs to the state, and the only thinking you can do is that which is permitted by the state. So, what do you think would have happened to Darwin if he tried to publish Origin of Species under ISIS? Well, they would have chopped off his head and they would have burned the book. What would have happened to Ayn Rand if she tried to publish The Fountainhead and Atlas Shrugged, these brilliant novels glorifying individualism under the Soviets? Well, they would have sent her to a Siberian gulag where her life expectancy would have been measured in a matter of months. What would happen to Einstein under the National Socialists? They would have murdered him. The point here, of course, is this. If your life belongs to you, then your mind belongs to you. And you are free to think as you will, as long as you do not initiate force or fraud against innocent victims, as long as you are not a criminal, you are free to think as you will, you are free to act on your thinking, to write books, to give lectures, to develop new theories, to invent technologies, to be entrepreneurial, to go into business, to start producing the new technologies and to compete with the old. This is what the principle of individual rights offers mankind. Notice what it does fundamentally. The principle of individual rights liberates mankind's best members. Either gender, regardless of race, nationality, tribe, it liberates mankind's best members, those who choose to use their minds. We are now free to not only think, we can think what we will under Hitler or Stalin, right? We just can't say it or act on it. But under the principle of individual rights, we can speak up, state what we think, and of course we're free to act on our thinking. We're free to create the wealth that human life depends on. Now, in conclusion, let me point out, now, I've been talking about material wealth, food, houses, technology, but notice also in the humanities, the intellectual wealth created under capitalism. Notice in the United States, late 19th century, small population, but notice the freedom liberating the thinkers, great, even with a small population, great body of national literature created. Nathaniel Hawthorne, Edgar Allan Poe, Walt Whitman, Herman Melville, Ralph Waldo Emerson, Henry David Thoreau, Mark Twain, continuing into the 20th century with such giants as William Faulkner, Ernest Hemingway, F. Scott Fitzgerald, and I would argue the still underappreciated Russian immigrant Ayn Rand, who wrote the two greatest novels in the history of world literature, The Fountainhead and Atlas Shrugged, and I will stand by that assessment till the day I die. So, intellectual material wealth, this freedom, intellectual material wealth, rising levels of prosperity, this is what global capitalism offers us. Just imagine global capitalism fully spread around the world. No more communists, no more ISIS, no more national socialists. We have free countries around the world. What does that mean? We've liberated then 7 billion human minds to work on the problems of human life. We've liberated. Remember, women have largely been oppressed all over the world, half the human population. Let's think of the brain power, liberated here by capitalism. The Ayn Rands of the world, freedom to think new thoughts and then to develop new theories and come up with new technologies. If we can institute the principle of individual rights around the world, then liberate 7 billion human minds to work on the problems of human life. Just think, the novels that would be written, the artworks created, the developments in philosophy and theoretical science, in technology and industrialization. At that point, we stand back and just admire this torrent of intellectual material wealth that will be created by global capitalism. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Bernstein. And now I'll give the floor to Daniel Kaddik. He's the director for South Europe Office of the Friedrich Naumann Foundation for Freedom, a non-profit organization that's focused on promoting liberal values, and his main focus is actually on promoting entrepreneurship and personal and political responsibility. So let's hear him, what he has to say about the troubled times in the divided world that we're living in. The floor.
Great, thank you very much. Indeed, I will try to stick to a topic and talk about troubled times and divided world. And as Andrew is a philosopher, I'm an academic bastard. I'm one third economist, one third political scientist, and one third lawyer. So I'm the worst.
We still love
you. Yeah, thank you.
We believe in a free society.
A free society, indeed. But I. When I went to university, Baba and I discussed it yesterday, I was studying a field that is not really brought to universities anymore. It's called state studies. So I was able to analyze the state from different perspectives, which gives you a quite interesting understanding, A, of how the world works and works not, and B, while people who work in single fields, meaning economics, laws, political science, always have, or very often have, a very narrow worldview, and have sometimes troubles, especially the politicians, to understand what happens in economics. But let me try to get back to the topic. So, troubled times in a divided world. And it's troubled times indeed. Everywhere in the world you see more and more cracks appearing. The world appears ever more divided than ever before. And it's not only the old East versus West, even though that has quite a revival at these days. But we have a multifaceted division at the moment. We have the West versus the Islamic world. It was said something about it already today. We have the Asian divide. We have the US with the isolationist policies that are put in place, especially looking at the Asia-Pacific realm, but also now looking over the Atlantic. We have the UK with the Brexit, we have Russia that's trying to be an empire again, thereby trying to set the world on fire in the process. We have Turkey where people are going completely crazy at the moment. We have the Arab Spring that turned into winter. So it is not easy at the moment. And then we look at the European Union that also appears to be more divided than ever before. And this is mainly because it has been built on wishful thinking. It has been built as a good weather project. As long as the sun is shining, everything is peachy. But as soon as it starts raining, you see that the roof is leaking. And this good weather project has been shaken up quite severely in the last few months and years. Just look at the external shocks that the European Union has experienced. You had the economic and financial crisis, you had the Ukraine crisis, you had the migration crisis, you have the issue with Turkey now. You have the internal shocks, the Greek crisis, and now Brexit. And all of that in a system where you have permanent tensions. You have politicians doing what they've been doing for quite a while, using the EU as a scapegoat for domestic policies. And then we have an unholy alliance of human nature together with politics and an increased speed of information. And what do I mean by human nature? Blaming others is deeply rooted in the human nature. You remember when you were a child and you were breaking something, you said, well, that wasn't me, that was my friend, that was my imaginary friend, that was a neighbor. And you try to blame someone else. And the further distant that person from you is, the easier it is to blame that person. So you blame the opposition, you blame foreigners, and blaming the EU is quite something very common because it appears very distant from the people. So it's time to put some realism in place and to say what we actually want with Europe. So far there has been so many voices, yet no plan. A lot of integration has happened without actually knowing in which direction we should be driving. So now there's a famous white paper 60 years after the signing of the Treaty of Rome, where there are five different options. Either we carry on not knowing where we're going, we have nothing but a single market, we have multi-speed Europe, those who want to do more, and we have doing less together, and we have the option of doing much more together. So an ever closer union that was Chamon back in the day was advocating. And this discussion is indeed overdue, as we have de facto a multi-level Europe, either with different zones of integration or a different view of what the European is, European Union is. So with different levels of integration, we have the Schengen zone, we have the Eurozone, we have the CDM countries like Bulgaria and Romania, and we might eat Moldova and Ukraine and the other countries in the Eastern Partnership. So when we finally answer the question what the European Union should be, it is actually easier to shape it, to shape the discussion, and easier to shape the way how we get there. But that requires two things. One is willingness, and the other thing is acceptance. What do I mean by willingness? Willingness on the level of politicians to actually define and integrate and also communicate this in a proper fashion. Explanations are needed to the people so they can accept and understand the changes that are happening. And changes are integral part of human life. We lead a life that is completely different from that was 20 years ago. That was is completely different from the from 100 years ago. And this changes happen ever more rapidly. And it's so easy to blame the others. I'm coming from Germany. We are a country of 82 million very proud football coaches. We know very well how the head coach of the national team could score, could have his team play better. And you probably do the same with your national team in Romania.
The German coach.
Yeah, Mr. Daum was now the head coach of your national team. I'm pretty sure you also know how you could do a better job. So there is no wonder that people ask, what has the European Union ever done for us? And I don't want to use the peace argument right now, but the European Union has expanded the personal and economic freedoms across national borders. And it has enabled growth by trade. And I'm not even mentioning, especially in Romania and Bulgaria, the extreme amount of cohesion policy and cohesion funds that has gone in those member states. But despite these advantages, which should be so obvious, people feel disenfranchised with the European Union. And it's seen as an elitist project with where the guys up there decide what the little guys should do and what happens with them. And it's a general tendency, but the factor of distance between people and institutions needs to be mentioned. That means the more abstract an institution is, less people can relate to it. So whilst in Western Europe, the European Union was seen as a necessity because of the war and so on and so forth, in Eastern Europe it was seen as an idea, something people wanted to belong to. Progressing, being part of something, and especially when I look to countries of Far Eastern Europe or old countries, also being protected. So in a lot of places, the EU could not deliver on the over-expectations some local politicians were putting on that. But again, that's not the fault of the European Union. It's the fault of the member states and the respective politicians and their governments, because they lead a dishonest debate. They hinder, on the European level, the implementation and agreement on certain policies, and they don't put proper reforms in place in the respective countries. And they make it very easy for populists. Populists take an actual or perceived problem and use it for their own gains. They play the messiah. They say, don't worry about that. It's not your fault. It's the other's fault. And I will take care of you. They reinforce the feeling of us against them. And people want to punish elites and choose the thing that they are least invested in. And that is the European Union. And it was most obvious in 2005 with the votes on the EU constitution. In France and the Netherlands, where the local politicians were punished, where the local people said, we're going to take away their toy because we want to punish them. And this surprising blindness to a fundamental problem is not new, but more perceived now. We have a gap between the people and the elites, and that has been very much discussed after Brexit, or coming Brexit, and now that Trump is there. And indeed, if you look, for instance, in the United States, 93% in Washington, D.C. voted for Hillary Clinton. And the voters, but also media and social political scientists, have been very arrogant in the run-up to the election. And they have not been seeing how much rhetoric there is against free trade, foreign investment, migration. And now you can see the celebration of the populace in Europe after Mr. Trump has won the election. But we also see something else. We have the uniting left and right forces and the anti-globalization alliance and them standing against free societies. And the great liberal philosopher Radu from 1997 already wrote an essay about that. And said, as the world is getting ever more complex, people also get more afraid. It enables people to do a lot more. It creates chances for a lot of people, but the increased speed of change also makes people afraid. And if people get afraid, they resort closing down. They're reducing the things they're comfortable with, their communities, their regions, their states. And then they separate themselves, they distance themselves from others, they blame others for what they do. They are blaming others for problems they might have, even though the others might not have anything to do with that.
Perception.
Perception, exactly. Perception is the problem here. And he predicts this rise of new nationalism, and that we indeed see in a lot of places. But to battle that, Ralf Dorndorf says conflict is a basic part of social life, just as conflict may even be an essential part of life itself. That means that we must engage with the illusion of expectation and problems and the illusion expectations of progress and abstract greatness that will ultimately lead to devastation and trigger more dangerous dynamics. But instead of facing the populists in arguments, mainstream often resorts to demonizing and thereby A, validating the others, and B, making them more attractive as a non-mainstream alternative. Trump is an idiot, his supporters are Nazis, the views that they hold are stupid, they are only worth of being ridiculed. That is what the mainstream very often did and does. So instead of going into discussion, especially political left has redefined reality via language till they have allegedly the moral or the factual high ground. And this is not matching the perceived or factual reality of most people, and it makes an easy game for populists or conspiracy theorists. Especially as they are, as they do one thing very well. They are using a language people can actually understand. And this falls on very fertile ground. Look at the polls from any country. People think that life is getting worse. And that is just not true. And we see worldwide, with some local exceptions, an unprecedented living standard, life expectancy, health, education. Yeah? Still, some 71% of people in Great Britain think that the world is getting worse. Only 5% think that it is improving. Ask whether global poverty has fallen by half, doubled, or remained the same in the last 20 years. Only 5% of Americans could answer the question correctly, that it has fallen by half. And even if you give chimpanzees three options, they randomly are scoring better than the Americans in that survey. So that tells you something. So then it is no wonder. We are told that the world is getting worse. And it's never been worse. There's climate change, there's war, there's terrorism, you name it. And it's accompanied by a social industry that is selling bad news. You have the gender pay gap, you have poverty, and these can be, to a large extent, described as alternative facts. And these shadow debates hinder the actual discussion that we need to lead in the societies. And the world is not getting worse. It is not just getting more complex. Information is flowing much faster now, and people need to make sense of that, and that grows ever more complicated. And mankind, just imagine, has made more progress in the last 100 years than compared to the last 100,000. And now looking at the media, we find two very interesting and sometimes very troubling tendencies. And that can be described as the parallel world of the media. And they are involuntarily enhancing the effect. And that is very simple why they do that. Bad news just sell better. Nobody gives a damn about the 40 million airplanes that land safely each year. It's the one that doesn't that makes the news. And the other factor about news is propaganda. I work a lot in Moldova, and I see what propaganda does. I see it in Germany, how Russian propaganda tries to influence the political discourse at the moment. So all this pessimism has also political consequences. Voters think things were better in the past, and thus they are more likely to demand that the government turns back the clock. 81% of Donald Trump supporters think life has grown worse in the last 50 years. Amongst Brits who voted for leaving the European Union, 61% that most children will be worse off than their parents. Those who voted against Brexit see it the opposite around, or other way around. So we have feelings over facts, and again, that's something that left and right have in common. Populists have learned that a great deal from the European left. That it is possible to actually engage and turn the tide was shown in the Dutch elections, where Mark Rutte showed that Geert Wilders did not have any really good argument, that Geert Wilders did not offer any solutions to the problems. And that is something we need to do. We need to engage in discussion. We need to stand for something, for anything, so that people can actually relate to that. And if you look at a lot of young people, especially in Western countries, freedom is often seen as an undeniable fact. Freedom will always be there. But it's not true. Freedom has been fought for in the previous times. So instead of engaging in political issues, they engage in sideshow fights. They think they have nothing to rebel against, but whilst they have everything to lose. So 70% of young Brits voted against Brexit, but only 64% of young people actually voted. 90% of the 65 plus generation did, and they mostly voted for the Brexit. So resilience and engagement is necessary. Commenting on Facebook or sending an angry tweet will just not cut it. That requires getting out of the bubble, not only using your mind, but actually doing something. We have seen that in Romania, for instance, in the protest against emergency ordinance number 13, with the 600,000 people who went to the street, and I'm assuming quite a lot of you as well. But we have the shocks now, be it with Brexit or Turkey. They not only come with a threat, but also with an opportunity. So we can come together in the European Union under a common threat. Brexit finally triggered a discussion that has shown that absolute knowledge and the assumption of inevitability of the Union has not been true. So we finally have to decide what Europe we want. So let me just close by answering one question about a coin. Would Hayek have been a Brexit? Hayek would have certainly not liked the European Union as it is right now. Bailout, European Central Bank, the pretense of knowledge. No, he wouldn't have liked that. But Hayek was in favor of European federation of some sort. Free movement of men, goods, and capital and the emergence of the single market are dealt with extensively in his essay, The Economic Conditions for Interstate Federalism from 1939. Moreover, in the prospect of international order, the last chapter in The Road to Serfdom. Brexit was notable for a leaner union based on the four freedoms. And it was not a vote for more subsidiarity and federalism. And that is something, actually, that Hayek would have argued for. The one thing that Hayek despised equally to socialism was nationalism. Economic and social nationalism, as well as protectionism, were the arguments for Brexit in the debate. This apart from the populism and lies from the Brexit camp. And that's why Hayek, in my understanding, would have not been a Brexiter. Hayek would have argued for a Europe of federalism subsidiarity to provide a solution to the need both to limit the power of national governments and return the powers of individual citizens and political units at subnational level, more regionalism. While it is its task of enforcing for common law, the supranational authority must be very powerful. Its constitutions must at the same time be so designed that it prevents the international as well as the national authorities from becoming tyrannical. And that is...
Point. This is Brussels.
That is not Brussels. Tyrannical is not Brussels.
Well, it's centrally planned.
No, but it's not centrally planning the economy. It is centrally planning other things. And I'm not arguing that the EU is great right now. I think it's being reformed. But I think the Brexit fetish of a lot of people needs to stop. Because it's ridiculous.
It will stop next week. When they will announce the exit.
Absolutely. So we have now a situation where we could come to something that's very close to the liberal dream. No borders that hinder people, trade, we have equal treatment before the law wherever you are in Europe. We don't need 28 armies in Europe and an equal number of border protection agencies. We need economic competition and social policies. And as you just mentioned, Brexit, and we're close by that, $60 billion will cost the Brexit. At least that's the tap that the EU just named. And what does the European Union have in hand? Well, trade. That is the thing that the European Union has in hand. With whom should Great Britain trade? If not with the European Union countries? We've seen that most of the, and the speaker in the previous panel mentioned that most of the trade, some 60% of the trade of the UK goes to the European Union. And changing that will be quite hard. It will take a very long and very hard process, and that will cause a lot of problems for the UK. And actually, the EU has the upper hand right now, because they can decide, because trade agreements are dealt with on EU level, or not on national level, in the European Union, that it can just say, you know what, UK, not going to happen. If you don't abide by our rules, it's not going to happen. And that might hurt the Brexit camp even more than before. And even Goldman Sachs just announced that they will withdraw their jobs from the UK, at least a quarter at the moment. So Brexit indeed might have one important good outcome. We start discussing about that moving on like before will just not cut it. Just as the populists might have one good thing, that we finally look at reality and get rid of semantic constraints and start actually tackling problems. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Daniel. Our next speaker is going to be Radu Mușetescu. He is a professor at the Bucharest University of Economic Studies. He is part of the International Business and Economics Department there. And his main focus is related to business government relations, corporate governance, and of course, international relations. Radu, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. It's a luxury to be the last speaker because everything that was worth was already said, especially by the distinguished panelists, but also by my colleagues from University, Octavian Jura and Christian Paul. So I just to have some thoughts on this very interesting topic, troubled times in a divided world. And if we think also at the general heading of this meeting, which is the world after Brexit and Trump, these two titles would suggest that something nuclear has happened in politics in the last months in American and European politics. And my perception is that somehow is a gross overstatement, because in my opinion it's just politics and usual. Okay, there may be some two events that may be challenging, but personally I don't expect tremendous structural catastrophic changes in world politics. I think that fundamentally every generation lives in troubled times, and I don't believe that the world has ever been only one world. So it is our challenge as a generation to deal with this. And if I may assess fundamentally these two political events, I think that obviously, as any other event, they may be a positive or a negative impact on American and European politics. You can never say for good that it was bad or good. It depends on how the other parties will react to these developments. And what I would like to start is that my perception is that we are living in a contemporary political culture, and I may paraphrase Mario Rothbard, which was speaking about the weak theory of history. That means things can only get better. And we assume that things can only get better according to our expectation. And obviously, both these two events, Brexit and the election of President Donald Trump, somehow was in reverse. Somehow it was a little probability to happen, if they happened. And in my perception, public opinion somehow became so neurotic about these two events, just because they happened after a period of, let's say, and I may cite Nassim Taleb from its Anti-Fragile book, the political establishments were building some fragile political centralization. For those who didn't read Anti-Fragile, I just like and love to make appeal to this metaphor. The ship Titanic was marketed as being the surest ship in the world, and at that moment everybody which climbed to the ship was convinced that it was unsinkable. And obviously we, a later generation, experienced that it was sinkable. So I think that the last two or three decades before Brexit and the election of Donald Trump, somehow the political culture is that we are building some political projects which are unsinkable, and centralization is irreversible. And these two events somehow, I think, should put everybody back with the feet on the ground. And the reality of human society is that we are in a permanent dynamic, and ups and downs should always happen. So from this perspective, I may argue that both Brexit and this election should offer the incentives for people to come back to politics, to come back to become resilient with change. Because if we take, and I may offer my opinion with these two political events, Brexit, in my opinion, has a dual potential impact. For one side, it may be good for the European integration, because it restarts political competition. It is, I think, very real scenario that the United Kingdom, confronted with new challenges, the political establishment may follow a path of rational and efficient, as much as possible, governance. So confronted with what seems to be the punishment from the European Brussels against this exit, and I read that somehow the European political establishment wants to increase the cost of Brexit on British economy in order for the British nation to become aware of the damage of their decision. This attempt to increase the cost on the British economy may force the British political establishment to reform and to be very, very competitive. Obviously, it seems to me that for the moment, Labour is on the very high probability to win the next election. And even if its leader is very left-wing, Mr. Corbyn, but I think that if they want to avoid the mess in the economy and society, they have to become more competitive. And this potential impact on the British political establishment should force the European establishment at the Brussels and the national level to reform and to become more lean and to focus on the common market and the freedom and not on the typical European cash handouts to any type of beneficiaries. So it depends on how Europeans, continental Europeans, will react to Brexit, because if Brexit may be successful for the British economy and the reaction of the European establishment will be to centralize again, that may convince other nations that Brexit was a good idea. I want to, this is maybe for example in Romanian public opinion, the specter that there may be other exits, or the worst case scenario that maybe European political construction will somehow fail, this is just a scenario. I think that we perceive it with so much anxiety because somehow when we entered the European Union, we were like a swimmer which boarded the boat. And in the moment that we boarded the boat, we said, okay, we are free, we are safe now. Anybody else can take decisions from now. And I speak not about the Romanian political class, I speak of every citizen who has somehow the impression that things can only get better. And every citizen, at least this is my perception, somehow is less alert on his obligation to be involved in politics. As Lord Acton said, a free society is a permanent revolution. We have to fight every moment for our rights, and we have to fight every moment for our, let's say, freedom. Nobody will do that, neither Brussels or neither other political construction. So we should not be neurotic about this scenario. I think it won't happen, but on the other hand, we should be more involved and more aware of what's happening with our own destinies. On the other hand, the election of President Trump is again for me somehow a bubble than is the discussion around him, because in my personal opinion, Donald Trump is some kind of social democrat. He may be perceived as libertarian only from the socialist position. Because if you really look at his statements, he's soft, and it seems to be softening after a few months in presidency. His loudest proposals were somehow reversed. For example, Obamacare will be replaced, it seems to be, with some kind of Trump care. And his statement was, we make certain changes, but frankly, very little. So this is the big revolution in social security and in US. In the field of national security, if he had the shortest-lived national security advisor, Mr. General Michael Flynn, and again, it seems that he gave up a certain agenda he had at one point. China policy, after the initial days and weeks of the presidency, reversed. Last week, President Xi Jinping said about his discussion with Mr. Trump on the phone that he welcomes the willingness of President Trump to broaden cooperation between the US and China. So what remains in true is some kind of economic nationalism, but again, I think it will be short-lived, because as soon as the American consumer will experience a loss of welfare, that will reverse. So somehow I'm a little bit astonished by how much support libertarians award to President Trump, because I think that it's a political strategic mistake. In fact, even the term libertarian today is so popular. I experienced at an event two or three weeks ago, a Romanian parliamentarian for 20 years in the Romanian parliament, and he said he's a libertarian. Again, maybe as opposed to the socialist guys in the same chamber, he may have the impression that himself is a supporter of liberty. So I think that both Brexit and President Trump election should force everybody to go back on their feet and to remember that you have to take your own security, prosperity in your own hands, because that's the way that much your society deals with. Small nations usually enjoy such kind of protection, of general protection from US. But I think that there is a little bit of moral hazard here, because such, for example, Eastern European nations should learn also and should not forget how to deal with bad guys in your neighborhood. So I welcome, let's say, as an observer, these two political events, and I think that they may have the potential for a very positive development. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Radu. And now we have like 20 minutes for questions and answers. So please feel free to start. Barbara.
Well, I'm sorry, I cannot resist, but I have to answer Daniel. If we criticize Brussels and the European Union, then I think we do it for good reason. Because what we have started, or the project started out as a big peace project. And what back then, at the Treaty of Rome, which by the way was not the federalist Europe that was originally planned because of the French denied to sign it 3 years before, in 1954, if we had this original plan, we would still all be in good shape. We would have a Europe which with a lot of subsidiarity, with regions that were competing, with the four European freedoms in place, and common borders. And a governing Brussels that would be easy. What people in Brussels these days, and I criticize Juncker and Schulz equally, and many others there as well. When Schulz had left and is now fighting on the German front, but he really left a lot of trouble there. Imagine what those guys think. They look at the American model, and I'm looking at America now. Imagine if not only President Trump would run this country, but the 50 governors would meet quarterly, discuss, debate, and make decisions, or not decisions, because one of the 50 governors just simply blocks a suggestion. Where would this country go and be? And this is what the guys in Brussels have in mind for Europe. And I mean, we can see that with the 28 states, soon only 27 states. This does not work. This concept doesn't work. So we have to look at, this is the worst case scenario. Of course, as a pro-market person, I prefer the best case scenario, which for me would be a Europe of competing regions, where subsidiarity is respected and where we can be flexible, but never follow this one-size-fits-all. And this one-size-fits-all problem was the issue with Brexit. And whether it's on the economic front, or whether it's on the legal front, or on the reform front, there are many, because it's interwoven. And therefore, I think you must not make it that easy and that simple. And if you look at the 1939 concept of Hayek for a federal Europe, there are many boxes that we can check and say, yes, done, no. And then it comes to this criticism that I have. But you're right, when it comes to nationalism, he hated it. And this is also one point. And this is the negative consequences that we see these days, the emergence of nationalism. We should rather look at our roots, at our regionalism. And we had the debate, you are a Hamburger, I'm a Tyrolean. You claim you're Hamburg, German, and then European. I'm a Tyrolean, nothing, and then European. I don't think I'm an Austrian. I'm a Tyrolean, because this is my direct roots. And maybe we should reconsider those things, and, you know, just to be more provocative on this front. Thank you.
Number one, well, we have a slight problem that goes both for the European Union and for free trade agreements. And these are national standards. And this is reality. And we can't argue that away. And one thing the European Union has done, successfully or unsuccessfully, created standards for certain things within the European Union. And that is also the biggest part of these trade negotiations between the US and Europe. How do we compare standards to, so that in the existing legal framework, I'm just arguing from that perspective, that in the existing legal framework in the respective realms or countries, the goods and services of the other realm can be actually utilized. And that is the fundamental problem. And that is also a big problem that I see if we go back to microstates or and so on and so forth, how we deal with the transition from the state we have right now to the perceived ideal state that would be regionalism and individual trade regimes. Two, the European Union just didn't develop, there was the Treaty of Rome, and then the bureaucrats came in, and then there was the big European Union that we have right now. There were a bunch of decisions that mostly were supported by the European Council. And that European Council consists of representatives from the member states, meaning the ministers or head of states. So they actually decided what we have right now without actually deciding at any point where we want to go. And instead of something, I think we're quite close, of having a level of extreme subsidiarity, meaning national defense abolished in support of a European defense, European external border protection, jointly, because there's no point in having that individually. Because Mr. Trump now whines that Europeans are not spending enough money on defense. We're actually doing that. We spend enough money on defense. And this retarded move, sorry to say that, to increase the defense budget so many fold, while the US is spending so many times more money on global defense than all their, let's call them, competitors. It's just stupid. And we should be talking about reforming that kind of system in Europe, but asking the question first, what Europe do we want? And there we are again together, I think, a Europe in a common framework with free trade of goods and services, free movement of people, but therefore we need a framework, and that is just reality, but as subsidiary as possible.
I have a remark to Andrew Bernstein. I'm from Republic of Moldova, so we are feeling the consequences of communism, so I'm not a communist adept. I've also been to United States three summers, so I have traveled a lot on the West Coast and East Coast, so I have seen kind of the best that the United States can give. And I think that not socialism is a part of capitalism, but capitalism is a part of socialism. I think socialism is superior to capitalism. And that's what the number says. And if we see the rankings, United States in the first by the GDP, but United States is not in top 10 happiest country in the world. United States is not in top 10 the country that has the best health care in the world. United States is not in the top 10 best country that has the best system of education. So what's the point to have the money and not spending them wisely? And we had the country in the top that are Switzerland, that are Germany, that are Finland, Sweden, the countries that they work together and they don't think that individually you can do. You can work and you can succeed if you work together. And the small things that you said differ, socialism and capitalism, it's, they actually play a big role. It's system of education and healthcare. And that's what makes socialism, for me, more superior to capitalism. And that's why these countries are happiest and healthiest and smarter than the United States that are the completely capitalist. And if you speak about great achievements of a capitalist country, you have also to remember the people from the ancient and from the middle age of Europe who have invented and made the great inventions being a part of a socialist kind of countries, right? And even Steve Jobs, Elon Musk, and Bill Gates, they all still work in a socialist framework within their companies because they do not think that there can be individual work in a company. And it's extreme to compare ISIS and socialism, but it's same if I would say that capitalism is PepsiCo industry and pharmacy. Because in the United States, when you can buy for 90 cents 3 liters of Coca-Cola and plain water, $2 for half liter, and then you have 27.8% of Americans who have diabetes, this is the utmost of capitalism, where the pharmacy, where they developed in the freedom, they got to work with a sugar company that affect people directly. That's it. I might be wrong, I don't study politics. So.
Thank you for that.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't even know where to begin. But, I mean, this, first of all, this idea that such and such a country is happier than the United States, I mean, that's an utterly subjective assessment. Measured by whom, by what criteria, using what standards. I'll give you some hard facts. I know what country people around the world want to go to. In fact, there's so many people that want to go to this particular country that there's some guy who's the political leader that wants to build a goddamn wall to, you know, to keep them out. And then, you know, they're not trying to keep them out of the socialist countries, bro.
About Americans,
why don't you shut up and listen? The Iron Curtain was built around socialist countries, and it was not to keep people from coming in. It was to keep people from leaving. Socialism sucks, to put it simply. I already made that case. I don't know if you were listening or not. Socialism is not Sweden or, you know, current Romania. Socialism is North Korea. It means there's no individual rights. Your life belongs to the state. Your life has been socialized. There's one thing the socialists excel at, and that's murdering innocent people. The countries in the world that are free and prosperous are at the very least semi-capitalist. If you value human life, you want individual rights. It means your life belongs to you and you can pursue your own happiness. Under full socialism, doesn't happen. Now, under the semi-socialist mixed economies, that can happen because they're partly capitalist. I already made this case.
Okay. And just as you were mentioning Germany, I feel obliged to ask. But first, by asking you one thing, where does North Korea or Venezuela stand in the happiness ranking?
Well, I was just comparing.
No, where does it stand? Where does North Korea stand?
At the bottom.
Well, yeah, where does Venezuela stand?
I don't know.
What do you have people in Venezuela have to eat? No, the thing is, you're making a claim here, and there's nothing, unfortunately, for you to back that claim up. To argue that socialist societies have been more successful than capitalist or free market societies is just plain wrong. And look what happened in 1989 and 1990. Which system collapsed? Not the realm of free markets. It was the socialist systems that collapsed. And if you look at the countries that are now still semi or full socialists, people live in the worst living conditions imaginable. Have you been to Cambodia? I was in Cambodia and listen and have seen what people did to other people because they want them to be equal. They killed them. My family lived in the GDR, not my family where I was born, but the other part. The first time I was in the GDR was in 1990.
Explain what GDR is because many people don't know.
Well, Germany was divided. One was the western part and the eastern part. Yeah? So I assume, obviously, he's a smart guy, so he knows that. So I was there for the first time in 1990. And I kid you not, we are going over the border, and it was like the colors had been drained because everything was gray. And I didn't make that up. There was a standard color for houses that they used, and that was a certain kind of gray. We would go to our relatives who were quite well off, because they had still a little farm that was within a collective. And there was a privy in the yard that they used. And I was shocked because I was living in an apartment with my brother and my parents where we had four bedrooms. One of them was used as a guest room. We had two separate bathrooms. And I had to use the privy in the yard. Look at all the advances in technology that have been made. They've all been made in free market societies. You have an iPhone. That would not happen. If you look at the comparison of the cars from socialist and capitalist societies, there is no point of backing your claims up. And if you mention Germany and Switzerland and other countries, they are highly competitive. They have a high degree of freedom. They have a high degree of competition within the market economy. And even if you look at those countries specifically, Germany and Switzerland, they have an extremely high degree of subsidiarity. One thing that Barbara and I have been discussing about, most of the competences are on lower level, are on local level when it comes to schools. So there is competition within these countries. And it's not the state that provides the good and quality vocational education in Germany, what is the backbone of the economy. It's the companies who organize that. That is the thing. So there is, unfortunately, No single evidence to back your claim up.
Well, I was not referring to extreme socialism. I was like half. But when Americans said that they cannot exist America with a free healthcare system and with a free education system, that's wrong because there are countries that they can have it for free, and they can develop the
it. And they have waiting lists of people who die because they can't get in to see specialists. But let me make one last point on this, and that is, if socialism were the principle or the system that enabled people to live well on Earth, then it would make sense that the most socialist systems would be the most advanced. The Soviet Union would have been the most advanced. North Korea would be the most advanced. These are the systems that would be the freest and the most prosperous, but they aren't. They're the most backwards. If capitalism were the system that retards human progress, then it's the most capitalist countries in the world that would be the least advanced. But they're not. The most capitalist countries in the world are places like Hong Kong, Singapore. These are the highest in economic freedom, and they're the most prosperous. The United States, late 19th century, turn of the 20th century, was very close to laissez-faire system, and it was this outpouring of advances that I just mentioned. The mixed economies do well because they're part of the mixture is capitalism. Socialism puts up the obstacles and the hindrances. Capitalism is the part of the system that makes the advances. By the way, a free market in education and a free market in medical care is vastly superior to government schooling and government medicine.
And just finally, as you're mentioning healthcare, which country has free universal healthcare?
Well, you pay taxes for
that. Exactly.
But
No, you're contradicting your own argument. You just said there are countries with free healthcare. Which country has free healthcare?
Singapore.
Canada. Are you sure?
Almost.
Just don't get me wrong. I think the work you're doing is great. And I think challenging and discussing, that's crucially important. So that's why I want to thank you for your question. But if you have an evidence to back it up, I'm most happy to change my mind. But in Germany, I pay 14.6% of my salary for my free health care.
God forbid you get really sick and have to wait. There's a waiting list to see a cardiologist or specialist.
So
people die.
One last question from there and one comment from Alex, and then we'll stop for the break. It's 6 o'clock, sorry. We have to stop for a break. So
I was hoping for two quick questions, but I will see. First, I want to thank very much to Professor Otto Bernstein, because it was a delight to listen to your plea for freedom. And actually, by the way, Daniel's last two responses, you saw the passion for freedom, because I grew up, I was only 17 in the revolution, and I remember well what it means to live under a regime where there is no freedom.
Did you grow up here?
I grew up here, yes, here in Romania. I lived here my whole life. I've just been to the States on visits. Not just to the eastern coast, but anyway, that's a different... my question for you would be, I know it's broad, and you're a philosopher, so you brought, but if you could throw just one thing that we as a country can try to do, even though it's 27 years and people have a lot of confusion, a lot of ideas, and we live in a world to help people think freely. Because even among politicians, as you heard from Radu, even who consider them liberal, there are states, there are big states. Government this, we're going to give this new law, going to do this and this. And when I see the passion and the compassion for people, I understand that, but we're talking about realities here, we're not talking about what would be nice, you know. And I know Canadians who come to Romania to get medical care because it takes six months, so I know the reality is not just... So that's one quick question. And the other question I have for Daniel and for Radu, if they want... What politicians in Germany, is it Linder, is it Mutter Merkel? Who in Romania and Europe do you see who are really people who have freedom as their principle, you know, not bureaucracy, not, you know, it's like in the election in Germany, or who, what new mind would say, okay, they're thinking. So these were my questions. Yeah. I don't have a remark in private for Daniel, but it says,
before I answer the question, I want to apologize to you, but I told you to shut up before. That was rude, I'm sorry.
Yeah, we're supposed to say this.
Yeah, we could talk afterwards outside. To answer your question, there's no getting away from the fact, you know, that human beings are the rational animal. Aristotle, you know, pointed, identified that a long time ago. Ayn Rand, very much in that tradition. And what we can do with people is reason with them, right? I mean, if we don't reason with each other, we're going to resort to brute force. And we know what that looks like from history. Dictatorships, warfare, genocide, persecutions, slavery, murder. So we reason with people. So the arguments for liberty are to be made intellectually. And as you know, Barbara points out, Professor Cohn points out very nicely, and Daniel from the Austrian School of Economics, you know, the economic arguments have been made from Adam Smith right to the Austrian School of Menger, von Bavark, Ludwig von Mises, Friedrich Hayek, Milton Friedman, the arguments. I know the economists, you know, haggle and they argue with one another. All experts in the field always disagree, right? But the,
almost like lawyers.
Yeah. But for the most part, the economic arguments, the economists have done a very good job showing that laissez-faire as a practical system works. That wealth is created and living standards across the board are raised. The poverty line goes from several hundred dollars a year to several thousand dollars a year under capitalism. The poverty line rises. As Bastiat put it very nicely, under capitalism, Paris gets fed. Right? And so does New York. And Bucharest. Now, philosophically, so I think economically, we need to educate people, get them to read the free market economist. And philosophically, literarily and philosophically, I think Ayn Rand has made the moral argument here that the real battleground for capitalism is on moral grounds. I mean, Marx and Engels argued in the Communist Manifesto that communism would outproduce capitalism eventually. So 60 or 70 years ago, hasn't happened, but notice it doesn't deter the socialists from promoting socialism. And the reason is their argument was never on economic grounds to start with. Their argument is on moral grounds. If you read the first book of the Communist Manifesto, Marx praises capitalism to the skies as this system of economic production. It creates wealth that undreamed of by previous systems. He said whole populations conjured out of the ground because capitalism produces food. But the argument was always that was on moral grounds, that the wealth is distributed inequitably, that the owners get rich by exploiting the poor, that egoism or self-interest leads, you know, people to exploit those poorer or weaker than them. The argument here, that Ayn Rand is the one who took the philosophic bull by the horns here, that egoism needs to be morally and philosophically validated, that it's right for me to pursue my own self-interest, it's morally right, self-sacrifice is wrong, it's morally wrong. You can read Atlas Shrugged for Ayn Rand's brilliant argument here, the way she dramatizes it in the book. But the point is, morally, an individual has the right to his or her own life, to pursue your own values, to pursue your own life. And that, of course, includes other people, your friends, your family, your children, you know, to help them. It includes the right to perform charity, to help, you know, to help those in need. But it's a choice. It's a choice that you make. It's not a moral obligation to society. Ayn Rand's an Aristotelian, if you know the history of philosophy, not a Kantian, right? Reaching out to your brothers and sisters is a choice you make, and it enriches your life in so doing. It's not an unchosen obligation. So I think we need to, we're rational human beings. We have the arguments. We have the economic arguments. We have the moral philosophical arguments. We need to educate our brothers and sisters. This is the way. This is the only way. We're rational animals. We have to appeal to people's reason. We appeal to their minds. I'll say as a practical point, before I turn this over to Daniel, I love Ayn Rand's point here that the single most important thing we could do to improve human life on Earth is ban the initiation of force. Is ban the initiation of force, including by maybe especially by governments, and then we deal with people by reason, not by coercion. We limit force to retaliation against those who initiated, whether those who initiated are private criminals or, above all, criminal governments, dictators. We need to teach people the initiation of force is out. We need to teach our children, our students, our friends, our colleagues. Force is out. We could disagree. We could argue. We could shun each other if we really, you know, don't get along. But the initiation of force is out. Just think about what a moral revolution that would be in human life. Not only marital disputes would be resolved by actually reasoning with people instead of, you know, domestic violence, but put an end to warfare, put an end to invasions and conquest and enslaving, you know, defeated populations, etc. So that I think is the practical point. We need to teach people the initiation of force is evil. We reason with people, and force is to be used only in retaliation against those who initiate. And by the way, my daughter, who's adopted from China, just turned 14. She's a great kid, you know, from China. And my ex-wife and I never spank her. That's not the way to, you know, that's not the way that this. Parents have to teach their children morality. Parents have to discipline their child. But you don't ever have to hit a child, and I don't think it's right to hit a child.
Well, what should I say after that last sentence?
Have you spanked your daughter?
Never.
There you go.
So, of course not. I completely agree with you that the initiation of force is morally not justifiable, except if you're threatened, that is, of the initiation in the first place. But coming to the question, who is the savior?
And who,
who, Well, there is indeed. There is a funny tendency in Germany now. I was the ones who got a heavy beat for arguing for to let Greece go default in 2011. And I got a very heavy beating, and also from liberals in Germany, who were the minority. We were trying to talk some sense into the people. And now the Freedom Party in Germany has adopted our position. So we are long right in the long run.
After you kicked out of parliament. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. But my party in Germany that I'm not representing, but I'm part of, that being kicked out of the parliament was the single best thing that the party that could happen to the party, because it needed to think about two things: who are we and what do we stand for, and the second thing is how do we organize and keep and mobilize people for our ideas. So we got a complete rebranding and rethinking of how we engage in discussions and what topics we want to tackle. We are still the party that wants to lower the taxes. We are still the party that argues for economic freedom. We are still the party that argues for equality before the law, and that includes marriage and whatever. But we communicate differently. And that's for a very simple reason, because I disagree fundamentally that human beings are rational beings. Human beings are social beings, and thereby, by definition, cannot be rational. They can be rational in certain aspects. But in order to convince people, you don't only need to appeal to their brains, but also to their hearts and stomachs. And that is how we actually get people convinced of what you do. If they don't feel it is right, they might intellectually grasp your concept, but they will never follow your concept. And that's something that the populists are extremely good at. They're targeting directly to the stomach, just as the socialists had done for so long, saying, they have this fluffy feeling of social justice, and yeah, that's so nice. But we can't do that, because we have to look at facts, and we have to look at how we sell facts, and that is the very hard part. And a friend of mine, Helen Zille, who was for a long time the head of campaigning for the Democratic Alliance in South Africa, she said something very funny when we were talking. Said, I asked her, so how do you do that? How do you make your messages? And she said, I shaped the message for the educated 12-year-old. So she had, back in the day, she had a son who was 12. And she was reading all the statements to him. And I said, do you understand what I'm saying? I said, nope. And then we would spread that. And start over from scratch. And that is something. We need to appeal to people in a different form. And there are so many great examples with Fianna Fáil in Ireland, with the Estonian Reform Party that has done such a great job for so long. And we have VVD, Netherlands, that just came out as the biggest party. So there is an appeal. It just needs to be better communicated. And the dangerous tendency that I see at the moment, we have the freedom fighters on the one hand that argue for more freedom, for more subsidiarity, for more federalism. They are in the minority. Then we have the socialists, who argue to a large extent also for a kind of, and don't get me wrong when I say that, a more national socialism. Germany first, Netherlands first, France first, you name it. And then this fluffy, nice feeling to that. And then we have the populists that are full-fledged national socialists, in part like Marie Le Pen, that are looking at the we against them argument. And we have to combat these two big blocks. And that is extremely hard if there is not a massive rethinking of the entire process.
The question about Romania is very
or your
big. My perception is that, for example, in Romania, there is no real political debate. So you cannot see measures.
We hope to have one after 6:30.
You cannot see policy measures even. Let's say left-wing. We have left-wing parties with a right-wing agenda, sometimes tax reductions and so on, and the right-wing blocks these tax reductions. But till now, parties were not the channel to help the system. But I think there are individuals in all the parties, and most probably there will be a time of maturity when in half a year you will see a party which may go up and up. But I think again that education is everything, not let's say formal education, but how you spread your ideas, like Richard Cobden and anti-colonial, that kind of grassroots education.
Okay, thank you all very much. Unfortunately, we are 15 minutes over the time, so we'll have to stop here. We'll resume probably in 5 minutes, so we'll take a very short break instead of having a bigger one. So 5 minutes break, and we'll resume with the third panel where Radu Shimandan will be the moderator of it. Thank you very much.